Welcome to this presentation. This is going to be a lecture titled 10 Landmark Studies in Psychology. So we'll be covering 10 pioneering, influential and novel studies in psychology. For each study, we will look at the method and the main findings. The emphasis is on social psychology, and at the end we'll go through 5 self-assessment MCQs based on the material covered in this lecture. Some information about myself. I'm a consultant psychiatrist based in Chennai, which is a city in southern India. I worked for several years in the United Kingdom. So these are the experiments that we will be looking at. I've listed the first 5 subjects along with the principal researcher. And these are the next 5 experiments that we'll be looking at. So we'll start with obedience. This study was done by Stanley Millgram, who was a psychologist at Yale University. So this study was undertaken in 1961. It was prompted by the trial of Adolf Eichmann, a Nazi war criminal, who was arrested many years after the end of the Second World War. Millgram wanted to study whether people would obey orders that were contrary to their deeply held moral beliefs. And this is Stanley Millgram. Subjects for the study were recruited after an advertisement. Each subject was given the role of a teacher. The confederate or actor, who was already known to Millgram, was given the role of a learner. The teacher and learner were in different adjacent rooms. The teacher could hear the learner but could not see him. The task of the learner was that he had to memorize pairs of words. After that, the teacher would read out one word of each pair, and the learner would have to give the corresponding word from that pair. If the learner gave an incorrect answer, the teacher had to give electric shocks to the learner by pressing an electric shock generator switch. The strength of these shocks increased by 15 volts for every wrong answer given, and there were 30 levels from 15 volts up to 450 volts. So this was the setup: Millgram the experimenter and the study subject the teacher were in the room, while the learner, who was an actor and stooge of Millgram, was in the adjacent room. In reality, no actual shocks were administered. Sounds from a pre-recorded tape were played for shocks at each level. Later, when higher shocks were administered, the learner would bang on the wall, pleading with the teacher to please stop administering the shocks. Finally, the learner would become silent, giving the impression that he had become unconscious. If during the middle of the experiment, the teacher wanted to stop, Millgram, who was the experimenter, gave the following verbal orders in sequence. Please continue. The experiment requires that you continue. It is absolutely essential that you continue. You have no other choice. You have to continue. The experiment was halted if either the teacher refused to continue despite the above command, or if the teacher administered 3 successive shocks at the maximum level of 450 volts. Two-thirds, that is 26 out of a total of 40 subjects, administered the maximum shock level. Some showed distress while administering the shocks, such as sweating, trembling, nervous laughter, and so on. However, despite this, many continued to administer the shocks. This experiment has been repeated several times, and the results have been remarkably consistent. About two-thirds show full obedience. This was also confirmed by a meta-analysis. The crucial factor determining obedience was proximity. That is, the experimenter, in this case Millgram, who was giving the order, he had to be near the teacher, who was the one following Milgram's orders. So Millgram made the following conclusions. I set up a simple experiment to test how much pain an ordinary citizen would inflict on another person simply because he was ordered to do so by an experimental scientist. The extreme willingness of adults to go to almost any lengths on the command of an authority figure constitutes the chief finding of the study. Ordinary people without any particular hostility on their part can become agents in a terrible destructive process. Even when the destructive effects of their work become patently clear, relatively few people have the resources needed to resist authority. We now move on to the next experiment. This was on conformity and it was conducted by Solomon Asch. Conformity is the process by which the attitudes and behaviors of an individual change in order to conform with those of the group in which the individual is a part. Lack of conformity carries with it the risk of social rejection. And this was Solomon Asch. The experiment was conducted in a classroom. All subjects except one were actors, and they were stooges or confederates of the experimenter. The subjects were told that they were going to take part in a test of vision. A series of lines were shown and the subjects were asked very simple questions such as which line is the longest, which lines are of the same length, etc. This is one of the questions that was asked. So which line in exhibit 2 is of the same length as exhibit 1? So it's obvious that the answer is A. The subjects were asked to tell their answers aloud. So the confederates always answered before the true subject. So in each group, there was only one true subject. So all the actors or stooges answered, and the true subject had to answer the last. The confederates always gave the same answer, whether it was right or wrong. Initially, the confederates answered correctly, but then they started to answer incorrectly. The study was repeated in different groups. So in each group, as I said, there was only one subject, and the rest were confederates of the experimenter, but the group sizes varied. Overall, 75% of true subjects gave at least one incorrect answer, and 32% of all answers given by the true subjects were incorrect. So this experiment shows that people, when they are in a group, are willing to agree to something which they obviously know to be wrong, just to conform to the view of the rest of the group. So the study has been replicated by altering the study settings. So the number of confederates in each group from just 1 to up to 15, the unanimity of the responses of the confederates, one or more of them giving the correct answer, and so on. And what you find is that as the group size increased, in other words, as the number of people giving the incorrect answers increased, then the tendency to conform with the incorrect answer increased. But then it reached a certain level of about 36%, beyond which it did not seem to go up. So the next study was the prison experiment. So Philip Zimbardo was a professor of psychology at Stanford University. So this experiment was called the Stanford Prison Study and was done in 1971. The purpose was to study the psychological effects of becoming either a prisoner or a prison guard. And this is Philip Zimbardo. And this was the advertisement that was given in the local paper to recruit subjects to the study. Twenty-four volunteers were selected. They were randomly assigned to take on the role of either prisoners or prison guards. Zimbardo acted as the prison superintendent, and his assistant took on the role of warden. Those who had to be prisoners were arrested from their homes, charged with armed robbery. They were then taken to the local police station, where they had their fingerprints and photos taken. After that, they were moved to the prison, which was a basement area in Stanford that was converted into a jail. At the jail, they were strip searched. The prison guards wore khaki uniforms. They also wore sunglasses to avoid eye contact with the prisoners. They were given wooden batons. The prisoners were given ill-fitting, uncomfortable clothes. They also had chains in their ankles. The guards addressed the prisoners not by their names, but by calling out their prison numbers. And these are some of the photographs from the original experiment. The prisoners and prison guards adapted to their respective roles very quickly. Prison guards started being sadistic towards the prisoners. The prisoners in turn protested by rioting and barricading. Some of the prisoners were placed by the prison guards in solitary confinement. Some were even denied basic comforts, so their mattresses were taken away and they were forced to sleep on the concrete floor. Despite being clearly instructed at the beginning of the study not to use any physical violence, the guards started doing so. Both prisoners and prison guards seem to have internalized and identified with their respective roles very strongly. Due to the potentially dangerous situation that was developing and was also deteriorating quite fast, Zimbardo decided to suspend the study after just 6 days, even though he had originally planned for it to last for 2 weeks. The study's results showed that the situation in which a person is placed in can result in the person exhibiting behaviors that are not part of that person's usual personality. The findings of this study are consistent with those of Millgram's obedience study, in which subjects displayed behaviors that were uncharacteristic of them. The next subject is aggression. The researcher was Albert Bandura, who was also a psychology professor at Stanford University. The experiment was called the Bobo Doll Experiment. The study was conducted in 1961. This is Albert Bandura. The study subjects were 72 children, 36 boys and 36 girls, all aged between 3 and 6 years. Bandura was of the opinion that aggression can be explained at least in part by the social learning theory, that is, that children learn and then display aggression by observing and then imitating adults who display aggression. The children were exposed to 3 kinds of adult behaviors. The first was aggression towards a Bobo doll exhibited by an adult of the same gender as that of the child, and aggression exhibited by an adult of the opposite gender, and an adult who displayed no aggression, just playing with toys. Each child was exposed to one of the behaviors individually. There was also a control group. This is the Bobo doll, which is a huge inflatable plastic doll. The aggressive adult hit the doll on the face with a toy hammer, whereas the non-aggressive adult just played with the doll and with other toys. following exposure to one of the above behaviors, the child's behavior while playing with the doll was then observed to study the influence, if any, of the exposure to the adult behavior. Children who were exposed to aggressive adult behavior displayed more aggression than those who were not exposed to aggressive adult behavior. And children who were exposed to aggression by an adult of the same gender showed more aggression than those exposed to aggression by an adult of the opposite gender. In general, boys displayed more aggression than girls. So these are some of the photos from the original study. In the first row, you can see a female adult displaying aggressive behavior, hitting the Bobo doll with a hammer, then punching it, kicking it, and so on. And in the second slide, second row of photographs, you see a boy displaying aggressive behavior. And in the bottom row, you see a girl displaying aggressive behavior. And you can see that the aggression displayed by the children closely mimics that displayed by the adult. This study provides strong evidence that children tend to imitate the behaviors of adults. Similarly, the behavior of children may be influenced by other exposures such as films, video games, etc. The next topic is cognitive dissonance. Cognitive dissonance refers to the discomfort that is caused by holding two beliefs that are in conflict, or holding a belief and displaying a behavior that are contradictory to each other. In order to reduce the discomfort, the person changes one of the beliefs or changes either the belief or the behavior. The classical example is the fox and the grapes story in Aesop's Fables. So this is the fox and the grapes. So the grapes are beyond the reach of the fox. So the fox sees some grapes and wants to eat them. So this is idea one. But the fox soon realizes that it cannot reach the grapes as they are very high. This is idea two. In order to reduce the discomfort caused by idea two, that is not being able to eat the grapes, the fox changes idea one, that is wanting to eat the grapes, by rationalizing that the grapes are sour and not worth eating. This is Leon Festinger, who studied cognitive dissonance. He was a social psychologist who did the pioneering studies in this field. Festinger and colleagues infiltrated a cult that firmly believed that the world would be destroyed in a flood on 21st December 1954, and that only members of the cult would be saved by being taken to safety in a spaceship. The members of the cult had left their jobs, given away all of their money in preparation for the end of the world. However, no spacecraft came to take them to safety, nor did the world end, obviously. However, the cult justified their previous beliefs by claiming that because of their goodness, God had decided to spare the world from destruction. So thus, in order to change the dissonance caused by two beliefs, the first belief being the cult belief according to which the world should have ended, and the second belief, which was the knowledge that the world had not ended, they justified the current reality by changing their first belief to be consistent with the second. The next topic is eyewitness memory. This refers to the memory of a specific event, usually a crime. Studies have shown that eyewitness memory can be distorted by a number of factors and so may not be very reliable. Elizabeth Loftus, an American psychologist, has studied this phenomenon using the example of reconstruction of automobile destruction. And this is Elizabeth Loftus. So this experiment aimed to study how eyewitness memory was influenced by different factors such as circumstances, prompting, etc. Two different studies were conducted using different sets of students. In the first study, the students were shown film clips of car accidents and they were then asked to estimate the speed of the car that was involved in the accidents. The students in the first group were divided into five subgroups. Each subgroup was shown the same clip, but a different verb was used in the question as follows. How fast were the cars going when they collided with each other, smashed with each other, bumped with each other, hit each other, and contacted each other? And these were the results. So as you can see, based on the wording of the question, the average estimated speed also varied. The stronger the verb used, the higher was the estimated speed. The maximum estimated speed was for the verb smashed. The minimum estimated speed was for the verb contacted. In the second study, students were shown a 4-second clip of a multiple car pileup. They were asked one of the following questions. How fast were the cars traveling when they hit each other, or how fast were the cars traveling when they smashed into each other? They were also asked an additional question. Was there broken glass at the scene of the accident? In reality, there was no broken glass. More than twice the number of students who were asked the question with smashed recalled seeing broken glass compared to those who were asked the question with the word hit. This study further showed that the way someone is questioned can affect their recall of the incident about which they are being questioned. This has important implications for how witnesses should be questioned in a court of law. The next subject is groupthink. Groupthink is a type of thinking that can sometimes occur in highly cohesive groups. It can have negative consequences. The group thinks as a whole without individually evaluating or critically analyzing facts before taking a decision. Independent thinking is sacrificed in favor of group unanimity. This is Irving Janis, who studied this phenomenon. He was a professor of psychology at Yale University. He defined groupthink as a mode of thinking that people engage in when they are deeply involved in a cohesive in-group, when the members' strivings for unanimity override their motivation to realistically appraise alternative courses of action. He extensively studied major US government decisions, for example, the Vietnam War, and showed how groupthink led to erroneous judgments being made. He identified characteristics of groupthink: excessive optimism about the benefits of the group's decision, excessive risk-taking in order to implement the group's decision, having no doubts about the correctness of the group's decision, unwilling to consider alternatives, not assessing risks of the decision, not considering the benefits of alternatives, not having a contingency plan in case the original plan does not work, dissent within the group being considered as a sign of disloyalty, stereotyping dissenters from outside as stupid, weak, evil, etc. He also outlined some strategies that can prevent groupthink. Each member of the group should be free to express doubts and objections. The preferred decision of the leader should not be made explicit at the beginning. All possible alternatives should be explored. Several independent groups working on the same problem should be set up. Experts from outside should be invited to interact with the group. At each meeting, a different member of the group should play the role of devil's advocate. The next subject is learned helplessness. This refers to the psychological state in which the individual feels totally helpless to alter their circumstances, even when they are able to. People perceive events to be unpredictable and uncontrollable, and hence feel unable to alter things even if they can. This is due to previous repeated exposures to uncontrollable stressors. The pioneer of this theory was Martin Seligman, a professor of psychology at the University of Pennsylvania. Originally, this theory was described in animals. It has since been used as a model for some psychiatric disorders in humans. This is Martin Seligman. So in his animal experiments on learned helplessness, Seligman divided experimental dogs into three groups. All dogs were restrained. In group 1, the dogs did not receive any electric shocks. In group 2, the dogs received electric shocks, which they could terminate by just pressing a lever. In group 3, the dogs received electric shocks, but the shocks terminated only when dogs in group 2 pressed the lever. Dogs in group 2 were exposed to a painful stimulus, but they were able to stop the pain by their own actions. Whereas the dogs in group 3 were exposed to pain over which they had no control. In other words, they were helpless. The animals were then placed in a different box. Again, they were subject to electric shocks, but this time the escape from the electric shocks was by jumping over a low-level bar, which is quite an easy task for a dog. The dogs in groups 1 and 2 soon learned the technique of how to escape from the shock, whereas dogs in group 3 passively continued to receive electric shocks, even though they were now in a situation where they could easily escape from the shocks. Thus, the dogs in group 3 had learnt helplessness during their past exposure to uncontrollable events. They then transferred that helplessness into the new situation when the event was now controllable. So this was the box. So you have on the left compartment, the dog receives the shock, and by just jumping over this hurdle and moving to the right compartment, they are able to escape from the shock. Learned helplessness concepts have been used to psychologically explain certain psychiatric disorders such as depression and PTSD. And these concepts are used in cognitive behavior therapy models to treat those conditions. The next subject is theory of mind. Theory of mind refers to one's ability to acknowledge that other people have thoughts, beliefs, knowledge, and desires that are different from those that one has. Normally, theory of mind is present only after the age of 4 years. Having a well-developed theory of mind appears to be directly related to having empathy for others. Lack of theory of mind has been hypothesized to be a significant abnormality in autism. The theory of mind was first postulated in 1978 by David Premack along with Guy Woodruff. They developed the theory after studying chimpanzees. The famous experiment on theory of mind in children is the Sally Ann test, first done by Wimmer and Perner in 1983. In this test, the subjects are children. The experimenter shows the child two dolls called Sally and Ann. The experimenter tells the child a skit involving the two dolls. The child has to answer a question at the end. Where will Sally look for her marble? And in some studies, it was ball. And this was the skit. So you showed two children, two dolls, Sally and Ann. Sally has a basket, Ann has a box. Sally has a marble which she puts in her basket. Sally then goes out. Ann takes the marble out of the basket and puts it into her box. Now Sally comes back and she wants to play with her marble. So the question you ask the child is, where will Sally look for her marble? Children under the age of 4 would usually answer in Ann's box, because they know that the marble is now in Ann's box. Older children usually give the correct answer in Sally's own basket, because that was where Sally had put it in the first place before going out. In autism, even older children tend to give the wrong answer. The Sally Ann test is also called the false belief test. There are a few other theory of mind tests. One is the appearance reality task or the Smarties task. The other one is the false photograph task. So I have included some points about both these tests on this slide. If you want, you can pause and go through them. The final subject is the halo effect. This is a type of subjective bias. Halo effect occurs when the evaluation, either positive or negative, of just one aspect of an individual's personality is generalized to that person's whole personality. It was first described by Edward Thorndike. He was a professor of psychology at Columbia University. When he questioned officers in the military about their soldiers, he found that soldiers were rated as either positive or negative across a range of attributes, even though realistically the officers would have only known about some of the attributes of the soldiers. This was Edward Thorndike. Studies have shown that attractiveness is a cardinal personality trait. Hence, there is a tendency to attribute other positive personality traits to those who are attractive. Hence, the use of attractive models in advertising. Similarly, success is another attribute that tends to be generalized. Hence, the use of successful people in one field, such as sports stars or actors, in advertising. If one product made by a company is good, the good quality attribute may get generalized to other products made by the same company. halo effect comes into play in job interviews. And there is also the reverse halo effect, which applies to the generalization of one negative aspect of an individual to the whole of that individual. This is also called the devil effect. Before we finish, we'll go through a set of five multiple choice questions. The first question: the fox and the sour grapes story illustrates which of the following psychological concepts? If you want, you can pause now and select your choice. The correct answer is cognitive dissonance. Question 2. Regarding Asch's experiments on conformity, which of the following is not correct? You can pause now, go through the question and select your option. And the correct answer is option 4. So option 4 is the incorrect option. The other three are correct. So option 4 is not correct before, because the confederates initially gave correct answers and then started giving incorrect answers. Question 3. Which of the following is correctly paired? You can pause now and make your selection. The correct option is Thorndike and halo effect. So the other three are incorrectly paired. Question 4. In Millgram's experiment, which of the following is correct? You can pause now, go through the options and select your choice. Option 1 is the right option. The other two are incorrect. The stooge or confederate of Millgram played the role of a learner, and the majority of subjects actually administered the maximum level of shock. The final question: which of the following is not a characteristic of groupthink? You can pause now, go through the options and select your answer. And the correct answer is 2. Freedom to express dissenting views is not a characteristic feature of groupthink, while the other three are characteristic features of groupthink. And that brings us to the end of this presentation. Hope you found this lecture useful. Thank you for watching.